have any follow on and 20 minute speech. And the good news is I'm tearing it up because the president.
As mountain, he would swim the deepest ocean to be by her side. He'd be over Thursday night if it didn't rain. And my life expectancy when I was born, that's a source of annoyance to a number of people. That man, I must say, have to be down and up for human freedom, democracy, and civilized behavior. But as I look back on that January 20th, 3 years ago, I can't help thinking we have made a new beginning. In 1980, America faced a crisis. A month, George and I took our oaths of office. Inflation stood in double digits. The prime interest rate hit the highest point since the Civil War, and economic growth was disappearing. It didn't matter where you came from, whether you were a man or a woman, and black or white. You had scrimped, struggled, and saved. You send your children to college. 21.5% inflation, or 12.5%, I should say, inflation rate, was slamming shut the doors of opportunity. Make program to help every American, man, woman, and child. And it's called. Earlier this week, when they do, we'll be at the table, waiting for them, ready to go on negotiating real arms reductions. And we'll be determined that they will abide by the agreement. We still have a lot to do, wringing out more waste and fraud in government, putting more Americans back to work. It's easy to, when you're in Rome, do as the Romans do. Actions in order to bring down government spending. What we came here to do, when they find out that doing was good for the people, also turns out to be good politics. A broad and an open land that offers opportunity to all. It's a dream of a magnificent country that represents a force for peace and goodwill among nations. Oh God, thank you and God bless you.
Something that is affecting humans seriously. The reservoirs are affected, that the kind of metals that are found now in the water can affect seriously kidney dialysis patients. We believe that the sulfur content in the water now affects anybody who's got an asthmatic condition and so on. Alzheimer's disease, some research indicate has an impact on that. In other words, there's a and a very, very serious health hazard that we feel is there, in addition to the kind of destruction of recreational opportunities and wildlife and all of that. So we figure it is a serious problem, and therefore one that one needs addressing. We've pegged it in the Northeast as an $8 billion problem in terms of the destruction of our natural resources, in terms of the economic impact on tourism, a number of other areas, which comes, we figured, about $160 per person. We recognize your budget problems, and we support you on every attempt to reduce that deficit, and I'm not proposing any additional money for the federal budget. What we are proposing is a widely based cost sharing plan that would not impact any one area of the country substantially. We realize this is a national problem. We in the Northeast, even though we already require very low sulfur emissions in our area, are willing to take part of the cost, and have stated publicly as governors that we will be willing to share that cost with the rest of the country. We've got a number of innovative financing mechanisms. We proposed one that we've worked out with some people on Wall Street in New Jersey that would really phase out any fee on people's utility costs after a 6-year period. And by using innovative bonding and borrowing techniques, we figured we could get the cleanup and get those stacks built right away rather than waiting. The kind of program we're proposing could do it over a 6-year period and phase out any additional utility cost after that same over that same period. They also asked me, the other governors, to stress the fact that every bit of information that they've seen indicates there is a national awareness of the problem. Lou Harris spoke to our toning meeting and gave us polls that he had done on acid rain and showed him, for instance, that in the Midwest there is also an awareness of the problem, and further, there is a willingness, according to his polls, both in the Midwest, the far West, and the South, among almost 70% of the people, to share in the cost of cleanup. So basically, what I've been asked to say, what I feel, is that, first of all, it is a very, very serious problem. We don't believe, although we'll accept, obviously, further study, we don't believe further study is needed. We think the effects are there. We think the majority of scientists agree on the causes. And we believe it's very, very important that a national cleanup program start immediately. We're not concerned about which program it is, or we pushed our own because we think it may be the best, but we're not as concerned about which program it is as we are that a program get the support, and we hope your leadership.
Well, Tom, I think this is one of our problems here, isn't it? We're drafting a figure of contention. We're aware there's a problem, but I think I'll let Don speak to this, I think. It is such a gigantic undertaking that you want to make damn sure, and that's the place where it's difficult to find out, that you do have the proper answer before you embark on something and then say, well, we've done all this, and it didn't solve the problem.
But Mr. President, the key is that in order to get to the right answer, we must avoid, as you know, going the wrong route. But in order to avoid the momentum of perhaps the wrong route coming through Congress, leadership right now is necessary, I think, to amalgamate what has been a very constructive cooperation amongst different constituencies involved to put a package together that does make the balance. And I'm convinced that legislation can be drafted that meets the needs of making sure that the high sulfur miners are not thrown out of work, that opens up the markets to low sulfur coal, that addresses the fact that the Northeast needs to be assured that there is a phasing of a program that will eventually deal with the problem, and provides the basic research and development to bring online at the appropriate time the new technologies. We have gone through a whole series of discussions with the various states that are involved, and I do believe that balance of legislation can be achieved. My concern is that the opportunity is now to provide the compromise. That if we allow it to become a snowball issue, it will not be dealt with in the spirit of compromise, but really in the spirit of trying to push something through and then forcing this administration to accept what particular congressional leaders may deem is most appropriate from a very narrow viewpoint and a And that's where your leadership, I think, is going to be so crucial and instructive.
Well, Mr. President, I don't know whether Jim Thompson could give you another vision of this, chairman of the governor's conference. What we have in hand are a number of resolutions from various governors, various sectional governors associations, recognizing that there is a problem, suggesting something be done about it, and there may well be within all of those resolutions the possibility of compromise, but it certainly would take a lot of work to get that done, because right now they're taking very different approaches to the problem, whether it's New England, Middle West, the West, Southern Governors Conference just had another one that I saw this morning that certainly takes a different approach than New England suggests. Jim, I don't know whether you have...
Maybe it's a good time to give Mr. President the position of the national governor, where we're at, and then Governor Garrity and Governor Carlin can speak for their regions of the country too, and I'll come back and speak as the Western governor, two heads on the table. The resolution of the acid rain controversy has not been easy in the National Governors Association, as you might suspect. All of the regional views that the administrator spoke of come to play when we get together. When I became the chairman last year, I appointed a task force in acid rain, chaired by Governor Sununu. And he worked very hard over the course of summer and fall to come up with a consensus position for the governors. I attended the last meeting of the task force. We spent about 4 hours there. And we finally drafted a product which was adopted with just a couple of dissenting votes by more than a two-thirds margin. We thought it was specific enough to be useful, but general enough so that we could hold governors together and provide an attitude on the problem. We took that task force report to the executive committee meeting of the national governors, and there it was received, but not adopted, sort of left on the doorstep like the foundling. And so I said, okay, the executive committee will not go to work on the problem. The staff has been meeting, and they have a new draft, as I understand it, some very sharp division of opinion. I don't think there's any doubt, as Governor Kane says, that the people in my area of the state, or of the country, understand the problem of acid rain. They're very concerned about it. It doesn't make any difference where you live. If you evoke a concept that something bad is going to fall from the sky on you and you're innocent and you might be harmed, everybody understands that. Everybody's against it. Everybody wants to do away with it. The people in the Midwest are Midwestern coal basin, I guess, particularly, I think, are concerned about two things. First, some would dispute the notion that Midwestern emissions play as great a part in Northeastern acid rain as some others say. There is that controversy in the scientific community, although the preponderance of opinion seems to be on one side. Secondly, and I suppose it's important, in the last 4 years, we've struggled very hard with recession in the Midwest. Our area of the country is undergoing a lot of technological, economic change. We have our fears, too, on the side of making sure that our people are employed and live useful and productive lives. And Illinois and some other states are very much based in certain sections on coal mining economy. And the ripple effect of that economy goes out to the small town, the rural area, beyond it. It's not just the miner and his family and the mine owner and his family. It's rather widespread. The acid rain strategies, which would, in the words of Governor Sununu, open up markets now held by Illinois Basin coal people to other kinds of coal from the West, are seen as simply regional competition for economic markets in the guise of acid rain proposals. There's a lot of fear and resentment in the Midwestern region on that issue. I wouldn't be surprised, like Governor Smith or Kane, that if the governors would eventually come together. We know after our midwinter meeting in February in Washington, when it comes to you, convene for 3 days, because I suspect there'll be an acid rain resolution or resolutions offered, and we'll get to vote. We're still trying to get the executive. But I think it's fair to say that the governors are concerned about the issue. We'd like to be a part of the leadership process if we can, but it's not an easy one. From my own feeling from the Midwest, I don't think there's been enough emphasis in the past on going right to the heart of the problem. Get the sulfur out of the coal so that all parts of the nation's economy can compete, so that we are as free to sell our coal as the coal producers of the West, and the differences will be determined by costs which are neutral, such as transportation, and who's got the most innovative mines and things of that sort. But the federal government now puts fewer dollars into taking the sulfur out of the coal through new technologies than does my own state of Illinois. We spend more on coal R&D than the whole federal government does. And I think, obviously, the state doesn't have the kind of capacity to compete with the federal government. The federal government in other areas important to the nation has taken the lead in technology. We've done that in defense. We've done that in space. We're not much further advanced than the Germans were in World War II, when they were running tanks on gasoline made from coal. But we could be.